Ladies and gentlemen, to make it very interactive, first of all, we'll speak to Rohit. Rohit, tell me, is there a way to say that if I take three key pivots around this discussion, viability, ecosystem, and then possibly you can build the infrastructure that is required, because nothing is going to happen till scale increases, more aircraft come, there's a demand. What's the BOA's view on that? Can we reset the discussion on the general aviation and business aviation more first in addressing viability first?
Yeah, thank you, Kapil. I think very good session, and thank you for bringing me in. I think viability, I agree with you, it's a key issue here. You know, and we've been struggling with this viability issue on business and general aviation for a fairly long time. Pradeep mentioned a toy for rich people, and that perception carries on. You know, it's a long story, and we are in this chicken and egg kind of a situation where unless the infrastructure grows, the volume doesn't grow. So what is actually happening? The size of the pie has remained same over the years. The number of players which have come in and gone out have more or less kind of remained same. Yeah. I won't say more people have. I mean, same number of people have probably exited as the number of people who have come in over the years.
Yeah.
So we are just kind of stuck in a groove. And one of the key issues that we need to look at is how do we make this more viable, right? I don't have an answer for that, honestly, for you. But I think what really needs to happen is we need to get serious people into this business. And serious people only come in once they see that this is a viable business model. You said you spoke to NetJets. They said, no, it doesn't. We don't want to be here. The demand I see for NetJets kind of operations in India is actually amazing. These are the people who are using charter operators from overseas to come and pick them up from Delhi and Mumbai and take them to Zurich and to London.
Right.
You know, so it's not that there is no demand. So we continue to, I think, something that has gone on its head here in India is we continue to operate general aviation out of international and commercial airports. This is not a model which rest of the world practices. You're well aware of it. General aviation operates out of general aviation airports. So therefore, there is no conflict. Now, we are in a situation of conflict at the moment. I know Pradeep, in their own wisdom, when they are sitting, they figure out that this airline with 200 passengers or this small little aircraft with two passengers, who's going to get the slot? Obviously, it's going to be the airline with those 200 passengers. So we are not even talking about this problem. I mean, in this entire discussion, we have not yet reached the stage of when a general aviation airport will actually come into India.
Right. But isn't that also linked to viability? If the scales are suboptimal, diverge, dispersed fleet, cost structure very high.
I think once we address that, I think viability issues like Anurags, issues like MRO, the minute we give them an ecosystem out of which they can operate. Mm-hmm. Today they're operating out of an ecosystem which is absolutely unpredictable. Mm-hmm. You set up a business model and tomorrow airport says curfew time. Sorry, no slot for you. Get out from it. I mean, they made an FBO, and now they say we have no slots. I feel sorry for them who made an FBO and he wanted more and more general aviation aircraft to come in. Now suddenly Delhi says I'm congested. I have no slots. I'm sorry. Please leave. So they are put into a conflict with each other.
That's a fact.
So I think there is. We need to have a relook at this. This is a unique model we are practicing in this country. Hmm. Of general aviation operating out of commercial airports. Mm-hmm. It's actually wired to fail at the moment. Unless we are going to come out with some out-of-the-box solutions, where we had specific general aviation airports, we shut them down. Mm-hmm. There is one 5 kilometers away from you. There's HAL. We just kind of shut them down. We don't utilize them. Why can't HAL and Begumpet be used to set up good, proper MROs, give them the space, give them the concessions, build it up? Why can't the general aviation movement go entirely out of the big
out of the main airport? Yes.
They have no business to be, being out of Shamshabad or something
Tell
like
me,
that.
Is BOA then taking with the government and saying that, listen, before we talk about everything, Obviously, you're not Udan because there is a political effort and airports are forced to give slots. How do you not become that maybe 10% of Udan and create a pressure? First starts with taxation, rationalization, and the reset as far as MROs are concerned. How does that first step begin?
So, you know, we are trying to chase that first step. It's obviously the government has its own compulsions. You know, Udan is a dream for the common man, and the perception issues for general aviation still remains a huge concern for everybody. Somewhere down the line, it's time that people start understanding that everyone has a place and everyone has a role. You know, commercial airlines have their own place and role. Udan has its own place and role, and general aviation and business aviation
has its own
role in growing, you know, in adding a tool for the economic development of regions. You know, that's the issue. That's something we need.
I'll come to Kanika just now, and I'm sure you have post afternoon this session. Karan Bali, just tell me, I mean, I see tremendous passion in you when you discuss general aviation issues and economic issues. When you have outstanding issues, and it's again a business model issue, if you were to diversify the model and say aircraft management or fractional ownership, though I may have a debate whether fractional ownership is actually viable, and we can get into that debate later. 2 years back, we had a discussion at Hyderabad, in fact, in Taj Krishna itself, when somebody said it's going to happen in 3 months. I said, it's not going to happen. Why are those things also not moving? Why is such small issues getting stuck? And what's your experience? What does the DGCA tell you when you confront them?
Yeah, okay. There is an update I have to give on that. Firstly, it is basically a perception issue. Like Pradeep mentioned, it has to be seen as a tool to do your business, and the importance of it in the whole ecosystem where the faster economic growth can take place. That is the first thing, perception. And as you can see today, there is a changing perception on this issue. That's why the Joint Secretary was quite positive. And that's why I brought out that the non-scheduled operation start in a place, that is an indication that there will be scheduled operation after some time. But coming to your fraction ownership and aircraft management, in fact, we are in very advanced stage of discussion with the government. 3 months back, we had given a concept paper on both these issues, and I had a one-to-one discussion with the Joint Secretary. The issue has been referred to the DGCA. It was put on a little back burner because of the ICO visit, but we are going to take it up. And surely, I think I'm always optimistic about doing things. So by 30th June, I think we should have some system in place. Fractional ownership office is a challenge, I agree with you, because you have to...
Multiple issues.
Yes. But aircraft management companies, yes. Whatever were the perception issues with the DGCA, because followed my meeting with the Joint Secretary, I met the director in the DGCA, and he was asking me specifically what rules you want to be changed for this. So we are working with them. Of course, it is always slow, not to our expectation, the way we want to work, but we are working with them.
Excellent. Kanika, we discussed viability, and viability post that would be an ecosystem. One, do you share that view? And how do we bring viability? And what's that first step, what I asked earlier? How do we make that first step change?
So, you know, I think it'll always be a chicken and egg story, right? We'll keep saying that you've got to bring viability into the system. But like Rohit said, I don't think people are focusing enough, or there are any serious players in India who are actually focusing on building a private jet charter business. You know, I think there are a handful of us, 3-4 of us companies, who actually are focusing not on catering to our principal's requirements under the facade of NSOPs, and actually focusing on real business. You know, there's enough business out there in the market. We flew about, I mean, in this financial year, we've done about 8,000 hours across the country. And which just goes to show that even in a tough financial year, where the entire country's economy has been more or less in doldrums, there was sufficient business out there. We in fact reached a point where there were not enough planes available. You know, so we're contemplating changing our own business model, getting more planes into the system, etc. So I don't think, you know, the government or airport operators or anyone can do much to contribute to this viability. What we really need is a few more serious players who are going to come in with planes to actually cater to charter requirements vis-a-vis, you know, principal requirements.
Tell me, if it's viable for you, why is it not viable for many people who have the resources, know-how, brand, product, technology, cash, big players out there? Why are they not coming? If it's viable for you, why it's not viable for them?
I think
why are we not getting big players?
You are seeing a lot of international players get into India now. You know, without naming anyone, I think one of the world's largest players is very seriously entering India over the next couple of months. So, in fact, they're going to run a risk to us local businesses, you know, bringing in their big bank accounts.
I've been hearing, to be frank with you, VistaJet for a long time. So,
I didn't say that, Kapil, you did.
I have my issues with that as well, but they're a great company. I'm sure they want to progress. But is that one or two planes in taking an SOP good enough? How do we get a NetJet here? How do we get these big players coming here?
I think, you know, it's going to happen over the next 5 years if small companies like us can explore the idea of actually bringing in 10 to 15 planes over the next 1 year. You're going to have a lot more people do the same. Unfortunately, the average age of the Indian air fleet is 10 years plus right now. You don't have very good inventory available in the market for charter. The good planes that are available out there are actually only serving owners, is what I would say. So I think in the next 2 to 3 years, you're going to see a lot of planes come into India on a pure charter model, because what I'm also understanding from my own customers who happen to be aircraft owners also is that it's far more feasible to charter a plane than own a plane in India. Mm. You know, you've still got to bear with 12 days of downtime a month, 5 days of downtime a month, pilot every TL, ye ho gaya, wo ho gaya. Whereas when you're chartering, you require a plane, it's delivered to you under whatever circumstances. So I think you're going to see a paradigm shift in the next 5 years, where you'll have less ownership, more charter, and then probably you'll have a lot more companies come in with brand new planes servicing the market.
Thank you. Gentlemen, sir, we have a helicopter question to you. You touched a very important point, and I'd like you to emphasize more on it before we can ask other people. The whole commercial industry outside, I was talking to a Canadian helicopter manufacturer who came on a bilateral visit. And during the visit, the moment we discussed the designated airspace versus reported airspace, and she laughed at me. How can you build a commercial? In fact, she was contemplating to go to Agra, then have a planned meeting, because she said that nothing is going to happen if we have these regulatory and structural barriers. Now, how do we move this way? There is a willingness on the Ministry of Civil Aviation. They've done an exceptional job. But how do we convince other critical defense and stakeholders to say that this happens around the world, like in the case of AeroCity? It took, my assessment, tremendous cost in convincing the government, which is a model which is replicated around the world airports. So how do we do that with your experience? Can you share some insights?
See, my experience with the ministry is that the present ministry is very open to suggestions. They welcome it. When we had spoken to them about this feasibility of using Mumbai airport for this, they were open to it, and within 10 days they called for a meeting to discuss whether it's feasible or not. So it's only a question of you know, keeping after these people, projecting this case again and again, getting the concerned parties together, and even the airport authority was willing to look at it, but they said the DGC has to look at the regulations, they have to classify the airspace, and it can be done. It's not that it can't be done, but there are certain things which need to change, which I am sure can be done. They are willing to look at it, but the current situation is such that they are not in a position to...
It is not a priority. I mean, they have too many things on the plate.
Yes, so it's right? Not a priority for them, but they are willing to look at it.
Yeah, because if you see the stakeholders like Bombay Airport or the Delhi Airport, they're not interested beyond a point. They would like to get bigger jets. Yes. Those, the commercial rationale for smaller jets is not there. You saw today, Economic Times, what the Bombay Airport CEO had said, that is Bombay Delhi going to be more productive or Bombay Golapur? There are economic issues. The slot value in Bombay is very different. And it's not a priority for the government. But I have a feeling that helicopter can get sorted out more quickly than corporate jets. Is that a view that you share as well?
I think so. Both have got their own issues. Why do you say that helicopters would get...
It's a mass transportation, medical evacuation. You can go from one place to Vedanta. I mean, Bangalore airport, Bangalore city had given, because it takes 2.5-3 hours to reach the city. So there has been representations by eminent citizens to the government that we must have facilities because there have been many deaths on the road, people can't just move. There is, I mean, you can do Delhi to Gurgaon. The economics around helicopter from basically from a utility perspective is much different from a corporate jet. The dynamics different are very different there. You could just personally fly, if government allows, you can just fly from the airport without, independent of the airport operations.
You see, my view is that in our country, all regulations are made keeping fixed wing flying in view. Helicopter is one industry which the regulations are not favorable to the helicopter industry per se. But yes, you're right. If we keep at it, they're sooner or later going to look at it. You know, BA also has taken up issues on a separate framework for business aviation, for helicopters. I think it's a question of time, matter of time when we get this thing going.
Thank you very much. We'll start questions from here. And if any one of you have a question, you can just identify yourself and let me know who do you want to ask this question to. Anybody on the right side? From this table? Anybody behind? Right at the end, sir. Any questions from you? Yourself? Any? This front table looks, the corporate table here. Any questions from you? Yeah, please.
My point is very different to be referred to. We have a solid 5-star, 7-star hotel industry belonging to Indian brands and the foreign brands. Somehow they appear to be going ahead with the market trends and they are able to grow. The cost factor per room, there is no rationale behind it. But in spite of that, the growth is sustainable. Why, when it is business aviation industry, even if it has got a stigma of, okay, this is meant for rich people, this is meant for people who can afford much bigger expenses, it is not able to make its own space in the overall civil aviation scenario. When the 5-star, 7-star hotel industry can do very well in country like India, I can give you just small little example. There is no rationale at all in the room rates. For a very small room, at times, for some little show or event happening, the hotels start charging something like 7 to 8 times of the cost, and they still get paid. So if they can do this kind of dictatorship, why business aviation cannot grow? What is it lacking behind? Who is responsible for that?
I will ask.
We are going backwards again and again. And you said 4 years back, the owners were there on the Economic Times pages with the aircraft. Are they hiding? Why are they hiding? And why are the number of aircraft ownership reducing? If so, why?
No, I take your point and I ask them before. So I have, that question is for all the three of you. But I'm
and,
ask, yeah.
and, and